They sell it. They sell it and make it work that something like the weirder experiments beforehand do not allow you to do. The flow of everything on 2112 as a song makes sense. It spins and gyrates. It shows the flash and flare of Pert as a drummer. He is quite happily showing off, but he is not getting lost in the weeds. The band themselves never let the songs get too far away, and they keep building up to the point where it hits that amazing conclusion, and you have the space voice coming down about the Solar Federation, about taking control. It all works. It's this big, dramatic, whoa, here we are moment.
They finally have won the public over. They've won at least their fan base, the ground roots, all these people they've been playing to for 3, 4, 5 years, essentially, you know, with the classic lineup. So they took this record out there and you know, surprised everybody by winning the fan base over. And again, it's a very pretentious, complicated, progressive and hard rock album. It's nothing that the critics are going to like. You know, it's a strange, futuristic sci-fi story with Ayn Rand libertarian overtones. You know, they even dress pretentious on the album. It's got a pentagram on it. It's got a naked guy on it. I mean, it's got everything that that the critics are completely against. So they're not going to get any help from the critics. But it is the album that basically, you know, proved that what they were doing was correct, and they never looked back.
Well, 2112 and the tour that followed it bought us complete and utter peace, because all those people that didn't understand what we were doing, that were advising us, stopped trying. They just left us alone. They said, I don't know what these guys are up to, but it's working, so let's leave them alone. And that was terrific, and it gave us great confidence. And then we moved on and kept experimenting. And I think the lesson that we learned from 2112 is the essential nature of Rush is to continue to experiment. Some of them are going to be successful, and some of them are not. Sometimes you just move sideways. Sometimes you move backwards. But those steps mean that you're learning something on the way, and that maybe the next record, you'll take what you learned with that failure of your previous record and turn it into something that you could not have done without that intermediate step.
2112 proved to be a commercial breakthrough, with both radio play and a surging underground following carrying Rush to their highest ever chart placings. The band's success, however, brought with it additional scrutiny from the press, who were quick to associate the five-pointed star on the album's sleeve with Satanism and took particular issue with the dedication to Ayn Rand. The music press, especially in the UK, tended to be left-leaning and levelled the charge of fascism against Rush's endorsement of Rand's ideas. In the year following the release of 2112, as the group's popularity grew, the punk movement emerged, championed by music journalists everywhere, and articulated itself in express opposition to acts like Rush, both musically and politically. The antipathy reached its height in 1978 when the NME in England called out the band's politics and invoked the spectre of Auschwitz.
You know, we got in trouble with the NME in Britain around that time. We did an interview, and this journalist, you know, wrote it up like we were Nazis, ultra-right-wing maniacs.
Growing up as a son of Holocaust survivors, I found that just, you know, just so offensive.
If the journalist in question had have taken the approach that he put down on paper to the interview, I'm sure he would have had a very enlightening and earnest debate with Neil Peart, specifically, about the lyrical structure and content of 2112, the concept piece, right? But he clearly didn't. So it's a bit of a backstabbing thing. And it's the only real instance where there was this real kind of evident enmity between the press and Rush. Rush are, by their nature, very nice blokes, very easy to get on with, and not the most controversial band in the world. Even the stuff that the socio-political content of something like 2112 is not a fascist. Ayn Rand was not a fascist. She was an individualist.
Right around this time, it's 1976, punk emerges, the Sex Pistols and the Damned, and one of the storylines is that you know, punk was the complete antithesis to progressive rock, and nothing was more progressive at this point than Rush, doing these long, complicated conceptual things, you know, playing very artsy fartsy and you know, dressing really fancy. I mean, everything about Rush was completely different from punk. They were essentially the enemy, along with Yes and you know, people making these long solo albums from the prog world.
If you have that kind of left wing approach, then anything that you don't agree with is therefore fascist or racist, right? And if that would have been the general kind of approach of a music paper like the NME that wanted to be edgy and in with the punk thing, which was by very much nature a socialist kind of sweeping away of the, you know, underpinning or undermining the rich and the powerful, for example. So you just take that approach. And you say, I don't agree with what she wrote, therefore she must be a fascist. And if you write about what she's in, then so are you. It's a very bland generalization, but that's in essence what happened with that specific interview.
And this tension of, you know, what are you? What are you dissolving? What are you standing for? What does this song mean? And this criticism that results from that is quite fascinating, because you can tell how it shaped a lot of what followed. You can tell it shaped a sort of very ambivalent lyrics, though, in the next few albums. It's sort of like him trying to grapple with a certain higher public profile that I don't think he expected or wanted, but now he had to deal with.
Despite hostility from some sections of the UK music press, in 1977, the year of punk, Rush took the decision to relocate to England. There was a feeling on the part of the band that Mercury's promotional efforts in Europe had been somewhat lackluster, especially since the majority of Rush's musical influences had come from across the Atlantic, where audiences would be naturally receptive to their brand of progressive metal. They announced their arrival in Britain with a short tour in the summer of 77, before decamping to Rockfield Studios in Wales to record a new album, A Farewell to Kings.
When we did that record, the Farewell to Kings, we had just done our first tour of the UK, and that was a very, very exciting time. That was the first record that we recorded in the UK as well. So it was exciting to be in a different atmosphere and have the influence of where our roots musically were from.
I think the first place we played was Sheffield, and there was a council meeting going on, and they didn't like our sound check very much. What really impressed me is the, you know, you go to a place and you don't know how big you are there. Well, every place was sold out. They knew the lyrics to songs. They would shout, you know, like they do in Europe. They'll sing along like that. So we were like, wow. So that was my impression in England, that just how intense the audiences were. And also later on, the number of people they could squeeze into a place, you know, like Bingley Hall. I don't know if you've ever been there, but it's just a bare floor. And you'd look at it and go, well, they can put, I don't know, 4,000 in here. They'd put 7,200 in there, just heads squeezed together and swaying back and forth with the wind. So we were always concerned, you know, especially after that thing with The Who in Cincinnati, that, you know, people are going to leave and there are going to be four people dead on the floor because they were just so munched together that, I don't know, you know, people could get suffocated. You know, you get someone who's a little smaller, and it was always a concern. And to the point where the band would come over and say, you see that person there squeezing against the barrier? Get him out. And you'd come out and pop people out of the barrier because sometimes they were disoriented.
You know, Rush, as they move through their career, starts spending more time in the UK, and it kind of makes sense because they do have an affinity for British bands. I mean, progressive rock itself is almost entirely a British conceit.
I think they were always attracted to that kind of intellectual and kind of thinking man's approach to making records, as opposed to like a R&B or rhythm-based music or blues-based music that was more coming out of America. So yeah, I would say that they were definitely looking to England pretty much, I would say, for most of their career.
They got very popular in the UK, you know, from 76 to 1980, those 4 years. Rush just shot to the top because they were in the ascendancy whilst the bands who they come along with were faltering. Simple as that. So, you know, Deep Purple weren't around in that period. Uriah Heep were starting to, you know, fragment. lineup changes. Rush didn't. They've always, apart from that one change after they released the first album, it's been the same three people. That means a lot to rock fans. They don't like change. Wayne's World got it right. We fear change.
Rather than simply try to replicate the success of 2112, Rush sought to expand their range even further with A Farewell to Kings. Together with a couple of long extensions in Xanadu and Cygnus X1, the album included Closer to the Heart, a concise, traditionally structured song that gave the band a hit single in the UK. Synthesizers also started to enter their musical palette as the group broadened their use of instrumentation and musical range. On its release in September 1977, A Farewell to Kings consolidated Rush's recent popularity, reaching number 33 on the US Billboard chart and climbing as high as number 22 in the UK.
After 2112, the band was thinking maybe about adding a new member. They were growing a little bit bored with the power trio thing, and they had felt that they were kind of growing stale when it came to songwriting. So at the time, the thing was synthesizers. We need a keyboard player. But instead of doing that and hiring somebody new, what Getty did was he learned how to multitask, especially on stage. Lots of keyboards, lots of foot pedals, and we hear that difference between 2112 and A Farewell to Kings. A lot more bass pedals, a lot more synthesizer lines. It marked a new evolution in where the band was going.
You know, I remember as a kid hearing that for the first time, and my first impression was I was a little ticked off that it was not as heavy as 2112 was. It's definitely closer to a prog album than a hard rock album. On 2112, you could have seen the band going even more heavy metal, perhaps, maybe in the direction of, say, a Rainbow or a UFO or something like that, or Thin Lizzy. But no, I mean, they actually take a turn to becoming even less commercial and even more progressive rock, you know, completely out of fashion in the era of punk, 1977.
I think Farewell to Kings is the best Rush album. Easily the best of that early period. But for me, it's my favourite, full stop. It's everything about it, the sound, the title track. Obviously, Xanadu itself is absolutely fantastic, linked with, Coleridge's poetry. Solidifying that intellectual link that helps set Rush apart from, the run-of-the-mill hard rock bands of the day. It's almost the perfect Rush album.